Hachette Audio presents Maverick, a biography of Thomas Sowell, written by Jason L. Riley, read by Brad Sanders. Introduction. How would you like to be remembered? Asked the interviewer. The year was 2003. And Thomas Sowell, aged 73 at the time, had been on a writing tear. During the previous decade, he had published 11 books on topics ranging from education and culture to social justice and economic literacy. Unbeknownst to the questioner, and perhaps even to Sowell, the next 15 years would bring 9 more original works, expanded or revised editions of 5 others, as well as the 8th, 9th, and 10th collections of his newspaper columns and other writings. Asked earlier in the interview of which titles he was proudest, Sowell didn't hesitate. As an intellectual achievement, he answered, I would say A Conflict of Visions or Say's Law, works on the history of ideas and economic theory. When questioned about the long-term impact of his writings, however, Sowell demurred. I'm not sure anyone can assess his own work. I certainly wouldn't have the objectivity. Lasting influence is difficult to foresee, he added, citing the 20th century Austrian economist Friedrich Hayek, who is best remembered today as a staunch advocate of free markets. People who never heard of him, who never read a word he wrote, are nevertheless strongly influenced by his ideas on economic liberty. There are think tanks in Australia and Jamaica and South America based on Hayek's work that are now directly reaching the public who have no idea who the source is. For Sowell, personal notoriety was less important than having tested ideas prevail in policy decisions, regardless of who gets credited. I'm sure that at least 95% of the people in this country have never heard of me, and that's the way it should be. So, how would Sowell like to be remembered? Oh, heavens, he replied eventually. I'm not sure I want to be particularly remembered. I would like the ideas that I've put out there to be remembered. This book is a treatment of Sowell's ideas. It's a selective introduction to a body of work amassed over more than a half century by one of America's leading social theorists. Sowell's corpus is both wide-ranging and voluminous, and you will not find anything close to a comprehensive appraisal of it in the pages that follow. Rather, the goal of this book is to place what he and others consider his most important observations into context, and then trace the intellectual traditions from which those insights derive and the orthodoxy they often challenge. Nor have I set out to psychoanalyze the author or unpack his personal life in any greater detail than is necessary to illuminate his scholarship and respond to various detractors. For those who want a deeper dive into his background, Sowell has published a memoir, A Personal Odyssey, 2000, as well as a book of correspondence spanning more than 4 decades, A Man of Letters, 2007. He's also offered sketches of his upbringing and family in numerous columns and other semi-autobiographical tomes, including Black Education, Myths and Tragedies, 1972, and Late Talking Children, 1997. True, assessing someone's work while neglecting his personal character entirely is next to impossible, and in this case would be a great disservice to the reader. Sowell was born in rural North Carolina in 1930 to a family with no electricity or running hot water. His father died before he was born, and his mother, a maid, passed away giving birth to his younger brother a few years later. The orphan Sowell was taken in by a great aunt, who raised him as her son and hid from him the fact that he was adopted and had a sister and 4 brothers. The family relocated, first to Charlotte, North Carolina, and later, when Sowell was 8 years old, to New York City's Harlem neighborhood, where he was raised thereafter. A bright student with a tumultuous home life, Sowell was admitted to one of New York's most competitive high schools, but dropped out at age 16. He left home a year later, after a magistrate labeled him a wayward minor. and moved into a shelter in the Bronx for homeless boys, where he kept a knife under his pillow at night for protection. He took whatever jobs were available at the time, messenger, laborer, for a black high school dropout with few marketable skills. At one point, he was so destitute that the foreman at a machine shop where he worked lent him money to buy food. For a full decade, Sowell received his education from the School of Hard Knocks, as he put it. He didn't get around to earning a college degree until he was already in his late 20s and had served in the Marines, where he had attended photography school and taught pistol shooting. Sowell explains in his memoir that these events from early in his life had a profound impact on his development as a scholar and his subsequent thinking about public policy. In retrospect, even my misfortunes were in some ways fortunate, for they taught me things that would be hard to understand otherwise, and they presented reality from an angle not given to those, among intellectuals especially, whose careers have followed a more straight-line path in familiar grooves, he writes. I have lived through experiences which they can only theorize about. This type of experience mattered more to Sowell than abstract theory. His early struggles to make a life for himself meant daily contact with people who were neither well-educated nor particularly genteel, but who had practical wisdom far beyond what I had, he recalls. It gave me a lasting respect for the common sense of ordinary people, a factor routinely ignored by the intellectuals among whom I would later make my career. This was a blind spot in much of their social analysis, which I did not have to contend with. In this volume, I draw from those recollections, as well as from interviews I conducted with Sowell's friends and colleagues and from my own conversations with him, to present what I hope is a well-rounded assessment. Nevertheless, this is primarily an intellectual biography, meaning that my focus is on the author's scholarly output, not his life story. And as often as possible, I let Sowell make his arguments in his own voice, since one could hardly improve on it. The first time I heard his name was in college in the early 1990s, during a discussion about affirmative action. Someone remarked that I sounded like Thomas Sowell, to which I responded, "Who's that?" My interlocutor suggested that I read Sowell's Civil Rights, Rhetoric or Reality, a book published in 1984 to mark the 30th anniversary of the U.S. Supreme Court's landmark Brown v. Board of Education decision, and the 20th anniversary of the Civil Rights Act of 1964. I fetched a copy from the school library and read it in a single sitting that evening. My response was similar to the novelist Richard Wright's after reading H.L. Mencken for the first time. I was jarred and shocked by the style, the clear, clean, sweeping sentences, Wright wrote. Why did he write like that? And how did one write like that? I read on, and what amazed me was not what he said, but how on earth anyone had the courage to say it. Sowell's writing is lucid and pithy and confident. He combines wide learning and common sense and makes it look easy. He avoids sanctimony and sentimentality, even when addressing emotional topics such as race. Unlike many other intellectuals, Sowell has spent most of his career writing for the general public, not the cognoscenti. Technically, he left teaching in the 1970s after stints at Cornell, Amherst, and the University of California at Los Angeles, among other institutions. He has been a scholar in residence at the Hoover Institution, a public policy think tank located at Stanford University, since 1980. Even so, through his syndicated newspaper column, which he retired only in 2016 when he was 86, as well as through dozens of serious books written in plain spoken prose, Sowell became, for many of his readers, the best teacher they ever had. When I think of his writing, I think of one word, clarity, said the veteran journalist Fred Barnes, who interviewed Sowell for a television documentary in 2005. There is nobody in America who writes with greater clarity in columns, in books, in longer essays. Sowell, Barnes continued, essentially had a side career for decades as a full-time journalist and one of the better ones. He has written so comprehensively on things like racial bias, whether bias by people or racial bias mandated by governments around the world, Barnes said. The reporting in some of these books is extraordinary. Given my line of work, I'm always impressed by somebody who does great reporting.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.